This week we rode from the Uzbekistan border to Samarkand, or at least it was supposed to be like that.
So the end of our first day in Uzbekistan as we were entering town was Sudario.
And yeah, we were gonna ride to what? 2 o'clock?
Yeah.
Oh, there's a time change going across, so yeah, it was earlier than it seemed like. Yeah.
We got there. It seemed late because we had that long extra detour in Kazakhstan.
And the hour.
That added an
hour
extra
time
hour.
Change, too, on top of that. So to us, it felt like it was like 2 or 3 o'clock, but really it was like 12:30, 1 o'clock.
Entering Sudario, first plan of action was to find money, and we had no idea how hard it was going to be to find money. Uzbekistan is in the bottom five of worst places with finances and financial infrastructure in the world.
Yeah, we had no idea when we entered.
Yeah. Yeah, our traditional method of bring our ATM card, our debit card to the ATM and pull out money, which works pretty much everywhere.
Everywhere we've ever been so far.
Yeah, even in China it works most of the time. Did not work in Uzbekistan. All the ATMs we were able to find were out of order, temporarily out of order. I think that's bullshit. I think they're probably never in order.
Probably not.
Yeah, so that didn't work. We went to one, didn't work. We went finding another one, and it was marked on the map as an ATM, but the bank hadn't even opened yet. It was still under construction, new construction.
Yeah.
And we're looking nice and confused, and the guys across the street came over and talked to us and said, oh, there's one just down there. Went down, checked that one out. Also nothing. Won't take our ATM card. So back we go.
And at this point, I'm like very, very hangry.
Yes.
Because my body thinks it's like 2:30, 3 o'clock, and we haven't eaten lunch.
Yeah.
And we have no money to buy lunch, so this is becoming a huge problem.
Yeah.
You know when you get like so hungry to the point where it's like only certain food, like only a real meal will really satisfy you? Like I was at that point.
That's not how real hunger works. When you're really hungry, anything will satisfy you. Regardless, we were across the street, Kara was moaning about wanting to eat. And the guys in the restaurant across the street said, come over here. You eat here. It's like, and so I walked over. Kara's like, I don't want to do that. I don't trust him. But I walked over anyways.
This is what living in Asia for 4 years does to you.
Kara doesn't trust anybody. I walked over and they were super nice. I said, well, I have no money. The ATMs don't work. No money. They're like, no problem. Come over. And so I yelled at Kara, get your ass over here. We're eating here. And yeah, we proceeded to have a nice, wonderful meal, kebab meal from the Uzbeks.
It was
for
so
free.
Good too.
Yeah, they didn't charge us anything, and they were just happy to see us there. And then later on, they helped us get into the hotel as well.
Yeah, there was only one hotel in town, and we like knew where it was on the map, but we couldn't actually find like where the entrance was. There was no like sign or anything that said hotel. And so, yeah, they helped us get into the hotel as well. They had to call the lady to come and unlock it. Apparently, they don't get too many tourists in this town.
So, eventually, the money situation was fixed up when we went to the bank and went inside. We had to wait for 45 minutes for them to open again.
Yeah, they were on their lunch break and didn't open till like, 2 o'clock.
Banker's hours. They're open about 4 hours a day.
Yeah.
And they're useless during those 4 hours that they are open. But we went inside, exchanged $40 to a stack of bills, probably an inch and a half thick.
Yeah, so we tried to use the card first because there was one lady in there, like a receptionist lady who could speak some English. And she came up to us and she said, Visa? And we said, yeah. And she said, go over here to this window and this lady can run your card for you. I'm like, perfect. So we gave her our Visa card. And then she asked us...
Visa doesn't work.
Well, she asked us if we wanted U.S. dollars. And we were like, no. Like, are we in the United States? No, we want SOM. We want the local currency. And she was like, no, I can't do that. And we're like, what do you mean you can't give us your local currency? That makes no sense. So what we found out later was apparently in Uzbekistan, when they run a foreign card, they can only give you your card's local currency. So since we had a U.S. Visa card, they could only give us money in U.S. dollars. So the ridiculous thing was, what you have to do in Uzbekistan, which we didn't know at this point, so we ended up just exchanging.
It probably wouldn't have worked there anyways.
Yeah, so we ended up just exchanging like our physical, we had 40 physical U.S. dollars with us that we exchanged. But apparently, what banks can do is run your card, give you U.S. dollars or euros or whatever your local currency is.
I think they only give U.S. dollars,
honey. And then they literally, like, you give that money back to them, and they can exchange it into SOM. Like, that's how it works. It's just, like, crazy. Like, how does a banking system exist like
this?
Well,
there was locals that were taking out only U.S. dollars as well. So they have U.S. dollars in SOMs, but nothing else, I don't think.
You don't think they have euros?
No.
I don't know.
U.S. dollars.
The Uzbekistan banking system is, like, all kinds of messed up. Yeah.
Yeah. Hotel was rather expensive. When she said the cost of the hotel, is like, something like 330,000 Uzbek soms, worthless soms. And our stack of bills, which was this thick, proceeded to be about this thick as I counted off the about 60,000 that would have been left after we paid her 330. And so at that point we had no money for dinner.
Yeah, we were left with about like $5.
Yeah, so to groceries it was. When we went to go out to get dinner, the crazy worthless lady had locked us inside the hotel with no way to get out. So I climbed the damn fence, went out and got food for us from the grocery store, and came back and hopped the fence back in because worthless lady had locked everything. What a waste.
Oh, man. Leaving Sidario, our plan was to ride 2 days to Samarkand. But we were on our way to Jizez, which was the town in between, and we stopped at about like 40K because Justin really wasn't feeling well that day. And so we stopped, and we still had at that point like 60K to go or something, 60 or 70K to go to get to Jizez.
Yeah, it was a long ways and I felt like garbage.
Yeah, and we needed to get to a bigger town where we could actually use an ATM or the bank could use our card, because we literally spent all of our money that we were able to exchange and we didn't have any more US dollars left. So the people in the town were nice enough to kind of tell us like which major towns or cities had banks that would take our card.
Probably have banks that will take our card.
Yeah, so one of them was Jizez, where we were planning on going. Obviously Samarkand was fine because that's a big city. And another one they said was Guliston. So when we stopped at 40K and Justin really didn't feel well, it was super hot this day and we were like, I don't know if we're gonna make it like another 70K to Jizez. So I looked on the map on our phone and I was like, well, it's only 30K to Guliston, which is not exactly in the direction of Samarkand.
Yeah, back to Guliston because we had already passed it.
Yeah, we kind of ended up making like a triangle. So we decided, all right, we'll head to Guliston. We really need money. So that's what we did. We kind of turned around, made a little triangle, and went back to Guliston, where we found actually a pretty nice hotel with people who could speak pretty good English. Mm-hmm. And
a bank that worked.
And a bank that worked. Enough. So, yeah.
Still not convenient. ATM was still out of order, but we were able to get money from them.
Yeah.
So leaving Guliston, we decided to just take the taxi, take the bus to Samarkand.
Yeah, really, I was like so dead set in my mind. Only 2 more days of riding in the desert, 2 days to Samarkand. And then when one of our days was not in the direction of Samarkand, I was like, screw this. Like, I really don't want to spend an extra day riding to Samarkand. We're both miserable and tired, and it's just not worth it.
And so, who cares? It's ugly.
Yeah.
There's nothing to see here.
Yeah, and there's nothing to see. So we're like, we'll take the bus. We asked the guy at the hotel if there was a bus to Samarkand, and he said yes. It basically leaves like every hour, and here's the bus station you need to go to. So we went there, and lo and behold, everybody at the bus station says there's no bus to Samarkand. Take taxi.
Yeah, there were no buses there.
Yeah.
There was no evidence of buses there. The bus station was completely closed and run down. So yeah, we got in the taxi. packed up our bike and our trailer all into the trunk of the taxi. Kara shimmied in the back seat with the bike.
Yeah, I pretty much had like the bike in my lap. It was ridiculous.
Off we went. It worked out great. It was like a 2.5 hour drive for what, $20?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah. I think the first guy wanted to charge us 30 and we told him that's too much.
Yeah.
we'll give you 20 to get 2.5 hours drive out of you.
Yeah, but it really paid off to have our Bike Friday bike with us because we were able to fold it up super small and fit everything in like a tiny, tiny taxi. Like, I'm not talking like one of those minivan taxis, like, no, teeny, tiny car. And we made it work.
We got to Samarkand, found a hotel. It was the nice, cheap one, cheapest hotel we could find. It was kind of confusing riding around there because some of the roads on the maps that were marked as roads were actually just paths through the park.
We were planning on spending like 2 or 3 days in Samarkand and then taking the train. But when we went to buy our train tickets, the train only leaves like 2 days a week, which happened to be, I think, like Monday and Wednesday or something.
Yeah, it was a few days later.
Yeah.
When it left.
Yeah, so we ended up spending more like 4 to 5 days in Samarkand, but which usually would be just fine, except it was literally so hot. I think we only actually spent 1 day like exploring the town because...
Yeah, because we were tired from getting there, riding through the desert.
Yeah.
And yeah, it was after about 8:30 in the morning, it was too hot until about 6 o'clock in the evening.
Yeah, so we really didn't see that much of Samarkand, but what we did see was absolutely beautiful. We walked around the Registan, and we went inside of some, what was it, a mausoleum.
Yeah.
That was really, really beautiful. Like, the mosaics, like, just the entire building is just like these blue, green, teal, like, mosaic tiles that they make into all these patterns, and it was really cool.
We did eventually get over to the train station to buy train tickets, and it's not as easy as it seemed like. I didn't want to get too much money because Uzbek soems are
worthless.
Yeah. ATM right outside doesn't work, of course.
Yeah.
And they said, oh, just go over there. There's an ATM you can use. No, there's not. There's no ATM over there. We went around looking for an ATM for about an hour, never could find one. Eventually, they told us, go inside the train station. It's like, what? Why do I need to go inside the train station where they won't let you in without a train ticket to exchange, to get money so that I can go back outside the train station to buy the train tickets to go inside the train station? Stupid. But that's how it worked. I did eventually get money. We went, got our train tickets. ended up there to the wrong place. There's two places that have nearly the same name, both on the Caspian Sea, both
in Kazakhstan.
In Kazakhstan, but apparently the train does not go to the one we wanted to.
So we were trying to take the train to Aktau, and we ended up getting a ticket to Atrau. Yeah.
Because he said it
Atrau. Aktau.
It sounds basically the same, especially when you're trying to get through accents. It's just complete bullshit.
Yeah. So we thought we bought a train to the right place. As we were back sitting in our hotel in Samarkand, I decided to actually look at our train ticket, and I typed in the name on there into Google Maps. And lo and behold, it was a different city, also on the Caspian Sea. And I was like, hey, Jess, we have tickets to the wrong city. So Justin ended up going back to the train station by himself to try and get the right tickets. And it turned out the guy said, oh, there's no train that actually goes to Aktau. Just take this train to Atrau and get off right after you cross the border.
It's quite interesting because the information we had from other travelers was that there is a train there from Samarkand. So I don't know where people get their information, because I feel like I can believe the train station and not the fellow tourists. It's sad, but so much of the information you get from people like us, it's complete bullshit. Just complete bullshit.
Yeah, but stuff in this part of the world changes all the freaking time. So it's possible that at one point there was a train from Samarkand to Aktau, and now there's not, or maybe just like the day that we wanted to leave, there was no train. Like, and I don't know why he wouldn't have told us that, but again, language barriers are a huge thing in Asia, so.
Information is not easy to come by.
Yeah, it's not easy to come by. It's not easy to decipher. Like, people can get told one thing and think they understand and then tell other people that, but it wasn't really the correct information. So it's really confusing, but it worked out. We got our tickets and we were on the train.
So the train was hot as balls. We got on at 10:30 at night. And it still felt like it was 100 degrees on the train. There's no AC, no moving air. It's just hot and stale and nasty.
Little teeny, teeny, tiny windows that literally only open like 2 inches.
Yeah, so I get up on the bunk. We do have bunks and able to lie down and sleep or whatever.
Yeah.
And so I get up on the bunk, open the window, crack it a little bit, get a little bit of breeze, but basically sleep in my sweat for the next two and a half days that we're on that train.
Yeah,
and it gets even more miserable when the sun comes up.
Oh my gosh. This was literally the most miserable public transportation we've ever taken. It was insanely hot. Luckily, we were warned by fellow cyclists, thank you, Spoken World, that there's no AC on the train. So we came in knowing that and kind of like prepared. And we did bring our own food to eat and stuff. Because even though there are like sellers that come on the train, really obnoxious all the freaking time come on the train. The stuff that they're selling is no better than what, like, instant noodles that you would buy to bring with you, and a lot more expensive. So we just brought all of our own food and sat and just sweated for days. And we were right by the door, which was not a very good spot. So, and I was on the bottom bunk. So literally I had like the sellers that were selling their like nasty dried fish. Like I would get a fish like in my face like this multiple times a day because they're trying to like pass each other at the same time down the tiny little aisle. Oh my God, it was miserable. But at least we only had 2 days of miserable versus another 3 weeks across Uzbekistan. Whole lot of nothing out here. We got woken up at, what, like 2 a.m. to go through the border crossing procedures, which took like 2 hours. It took like an hour to get out of Uzbekistan and then an hour to get into Kazakhstan when we could actually get off the train. So it was a very, very long 2 days of train rides.